Less than 10% of the asylum seeker population in Israel is even permitted to apply for refugee status.
Almost virtually every and any dictatorship in the world in the last 30 years has had some contact with the Israeli security industry.
Hello, my name is Stanley Heller. Welcome to The Struggle. The Struggle is shown on 22 cable stations from Vermont to New York City, on the internet at thestruggle.org. Our YouTube channel is Struggle Video Media. We begin in Ireland. Margaretta D'Arcy is serving 3 months in Montjoy Prison for refusing to sign an agreement that she would stay away from Shannon Airport. She is part of the Galway Alliance Against War, and she went onto the runway at Shannon in October 2012 as part of an international protest against U.S. killer drones, which she believed was being transported through Shannon, even though Ireland is officially a neutral country. We have a bit of video of D'Arcy on her way to a court session and a protest in her honor. Then to a video created by David Sheen about the incredible treatment, the incredible racist treatment in Israel of African blacks. Sheen was in Connecticut last week and was excellent. Then from last fall, Maya Nguyen speaking at the Tree of Life meeting in Hartford. We begin in Ireland.
U.S. military out of Shannon. U.S. military out of Shannon. U.S. military out of Shannon. Hey, Margaretta, you want to say a few words about the U.S. military?
Absolutely, it's an obscenity. At the time that the government recognized that, torture, complicity with torture.
Yeah, okay, Margaret. U.S. military!
If you haven't yet heard my podcast interview with David Sheen, let me tell you that he is from an Israeli family, grew up in Toronto, went back to Israel at the end of the 90s as an enthusiastic Zionist, but within a few months was shorn of his illusions. He specializes in writing and filmmaking about the plight of the 55,000 Africans who made it to Israel and were despised by the population.
On May 1st, 2011, when the State of Israel commemorated Holocaust Remembrance Day, President Shimon Peres addressed the nation on live television from Yad Vashem, the country's National Holocaust Museum. There he claimed that out of all the countries in the world, Israel did the most of all of them to combat racial discrimination. This report by the African Refugee Development Center to the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination will present ample evidence that suggests the contrary. There are many groups of people that experience racial discrimination in Israel, but this report will specifically focus on racial discrimination towards African asylum seekers and refugees. These are the tens of thousands of sub-Saharan African people who have entered Israel in recent years by walking across its open border with Egypt. There are currently an estimated 45,000 asylum seekers in Israel, and over 90% of this population has arrived since 2007. Although Israel is a party to the 1951 UN Convention on the Status of Refugees, the state has no implementing asylum legislation, only ad hoc policies and regulations. Israel is very reluctant to grant refugee status, and since its establishment in 1948, only 143 individuals have ever been recognized as refugees under the Refugee Convention. Less than 10% of the asylum seeker population in Israel is even permitted to apply for refugee status. The other 90% are granted temporary group protection, which confers an inferior, unstable status. They are granted conditional release visas in accordance with Article 2A5 of the 1952 Entry into Israel Law. In late November 2010, the Ministry of Interior began to mark such visas with the statement, "This visa is not a working permit." As a result, not only are fewer asylum seekers able to secure employment, but they are more vulnerable to exploitation, and employers are less likely to respect their legal obligations to provide medical insurance for these workers. Without the ability to work legally, many asylum seekers are unable to provide for themselves and barely subsist. Many of them live on the streets of South Tel Aviv, close to the city's central bus station. The presence of the asylum seekers has altered the character of these neighborhoods, and the influx of a homeless refugee population has increased competition for scarce resources. As a result, asylum seekers have become easy targets for racial hatred. Some Jewish Israelis say that the reason they oppose the presence of asylum seekers in their neighborhoods is that many of them are impoverished. These Israelis complain that the presence of asylum seekers causes their quality of life to deteriorate. At an anti-asylum seekers march through the South Tel Aviv outdoor pedestrian walkway of Neve Sha'anan in April 2011, one particularly vocal Israeli woman screamed at asylum seekers who were quietly selling their wares on the street. This woman's comments give the impression that asylum seekers had transformed what was previously an upscale public square devoid of street vendors into an ad hoc flea market. In reality, the Neve Sha'anan pedestrian walkway has always been an ad hoc flea market, full of street vendors hawking all kinds of merchandise. One of the Israelis who participated in that very anti-asylum seekers march in April 2011 is in fact one of those street vendors. A month later, I interviewed him in front of his makeshift booth and confronted him, asking him how Israelis could fault asylum seekers for conducting commerce in the public square, while Jewish Israelis like him were doing the same thing, and in fact been doing so for years before most of these asylum seekers had ever even arrived in the country.
ויש שם פרוס, בדיוק כמו שפרוס לך פה, כן? אז פרוס פה, מה יש פה? בגדים, קסטות, יש פה רוביקס קיוב, פיקצ'ו, כל מיני, מלא דברים. תכשיטים וזה, אז זה מה שהיה שם. אוקיי, אז האישה הזאת אומרת שזה עזה פה, או שכם, או קלקיליה, או whatever, כן? אז מה המשמעויות
שלהם? אבל למעשה היא צודקת, כי זה מקום מלוכלך, כל האזור הזה.
כן, זה מלוכלך נראה לך?
בטח, יש פה נרקומנים, זונות, ערבים, רוסים.
כל הדברים האלו...
רושים. מי צריך את הדברים האלה? פעם זה לא היה. למה אין פה ישראלים?
וויט, אתה אמרת שהכל מתונף פה, ואז אמרת שיש פה רוסים ואפריקאים. אז אתה אומר שבשבילך, אתה אומר שבשבילך רוסי ואפריקאי ו-whatever else, כן? זה מבחינתך תינופת. זה מה שהבנתי ממך, נכון?
מה שאמרתי זה הכל אמת.
אמת זה שהם תינופת? הם, אנשים האלו הם תינופת?
כן, כן, כי הם לא היו פה לפני, אז היה פה נקי, היה נחמד.
In truth, the Neve She'anan neighborhood was a nexus for prostitution and drug use long before most of the asylum seekers ever stepped foot in the country. At that same anti-asylum seekers march in April 2011, one African man made this point succinctly after he had been berated by a crowd of Jewish Israelis demanding that he leave the country.
Neve She'anan, Neve She'anan, Maya Neve She'anan, Neve She'anan, New York now, New York, it's New York Neve She'anan, you see New York, New York Neve She'anan, Maya, כל הנרקומנים היו פה, כל הצבלים היו פה, מי ניקה אותו? המסתננים ניקו אותו, עכשיו יש New York,
It's bewildering that there can be so much race hatred in Israel towards blacks. It's not even an excuse that they use with Palestinians of the generations of violence and counterviolence. There's no history in Africa of hatred and violence against Jews.
I'm also from Jerusalem, and I also want to share a little bit about my personal story and background and how I came to do the activism that I do and then share a little bit more about what resistance looks like, not only for Palestinians but for Israelis who also want to resist the situation. And I always like to sort of follow along a similar trajectory to Iran in terms of describing what Israeli education is like. I think there's one photograph that I always like to use that I think really captures what I experienced as my Israeli Zionist education growing up. This is a picture taken from a real live kindergarten in Israel just 3 years ago. It's sort of like a graph on a wall, and I translated it for you, but I'll walk you through the graph. This question starts out, who wants to kill us? And then you have, from right to left, a list that tells you, in case you didn't know. So it starts with Pharaoh, right, going back to the Old Testament, going then to the Greeks, to Haman, another reference to the Book of Esther. And then you have the Nazis. I think Iran did a good job of explaining why that is up there. And then lastly, you have Arabs, just sort of the generic category of humans, Arabs. That's sort of seen as, very clearly, obviously, the last line, the last kind of link in that long chain of people who supposedly want to kill us for being Jewish. Then you have arrows pointing you to the conclusion of the graph. And then leading to the next question, which is, what do we need? And then in the largest letters possible, we need a country. So I think this really speaks to what Iran was talking about, and this is sort of how I remember 12 years of education in Israel. This is sort of the overall message that I got. And at the end of my senior year of high school, I was lucky enough, or actually a few years prior, I was lucky enough to have some exposure to some other truths that I was not exposed to through my formal education. And together, in 2008, together with 9 other peers from around the country, I co-founded the third public refusal letter of high school seniors in the history of the state. And we called ourselves the Shmini Steam, which is 12th graders in Hebrew. And our premise was very simple. At first, we said every general needs its soldiers. The military occupation of Palestine is reliant upon the foot soldiers who are doing this everyday sort of dirty work. And if we just create a mass movement of high school seniors who refuse to enlist, and by the way, if it wasn't clear, the draft is mandatory for both men and women in Israel, slightly different from here. The idea was that if we just got a mass movement going, the military occupation would have to, in fact, collapse. So 4 months into mobilizing and picketing and demonstrating outside high schools and handing out leaflets and organizing, we realized we're still around 10 people. And yeah, I know, it's sad. And we realized that that wouldn't quite cut it in terms of undermining the entire IDF. So we said, all right, we are 10 people, but we will make as much noise as we possibly can. And that is what we did. And we were actually, I think, extremely effective in that. We got wide coverage, both from international media and also, from more importantly, from Israeli media. And we really tried to create some movement. We did have several hundred endorsements and signatures to our petition of high school seniors from around the country. But in terms of actual a movement of a refusal, that was really just the 10 of us. Each of us in turn on the day of our draft showed up at the induction base and then declared our refusal to become a soldier. I was brought before a military judge 5 times, and I spent 4 months shuttling sort of back and forth between military detention centers and the only women's military prison in Israel until I was exempted on mental health grounds. And yes, I appreciate your sympathy to my mental situation. Yeah, in fact, that's how we all were exempted. And I think that's sort of a way to pathologize us and to delegitimize our message. So in prison, I learned 2 very important things that I think really helped to shape my political consciousness and really informed the sort of activism that I have been engaged with since. In prison, I was the only Ashkenazi middle class high school educated person. Ashkenazi means Jew of European descent. While some people think that most Jews are white or European in origin, actually that is not the case. We're only 40% of the Israeli Jewish population. In fact, the vast majority of Israeli Jews are actually from the Middle East and North Africa. And I was really struck by this. Today, and I guess to an American audience, it seems silly, right? Because in this country, it's very clear what color and what class you have to be if you want to wind up in prison. But in Israel, I was not aware of that then. And I was really struck by the fact that I was the only middle-class person and certainly the only white person in jail. And later, this thought or this understanding of who the state is really for and who the state is really serving would lead me to understand a lot about Zionism from a very different perspective. I came into jail thinking Zionism was a problem because it undermined the rights of the Palestinian people. Little did I know at the time, and I would learn this through prison, that actually Zionism was a movement of European Jews that very much undermined Mizrahi Jews, Jews of Middle Eastern and North African descent. And Iran and I can talk about this more later, perhaps in the Q&A, if it's of interest to you. But I think it's a really crucial part of the picture that is seldom discussed. So that's one thing. The other thing I learned in prison was in terms of class, was that most of the other women who were there with me were there because they had evaded the draft, either had not shown up at all or deserted their posts some months in, and all of them for very, very strikingly similar reasons. Many of them came from households where the father was absent. Many of them needed to help support their siblings. And the less than minimum wage payment, and when I say less, that's really an understatement, because really Israeli soldiers, certainly women, and I will speak to that more in a minute, get 1/10 of minimum wage per month to live off. So it's really it really doesn't cut it if you're trying to help support your siblings and your family or just get by for a family that's not middle class. And so all of these women were there, and I learned to think of them today as refusers, just like myself. They were there refusing to serve a system and a country that would not give them adequate pay and that altogether left them behind. And they just did it for different reasons, but they were there similarly, in my opinion, out of conscience. And those are 2 very important things that I learned. And they inform activism because understanding the ways in which the Israeli military is set up and the way the occupation is set up really taught me a lot about how not only the Israeli occupation is reliant on a particular economic situation, but also that the entire Israeli economy is actually reliant on the occupation. And sort of it's a sort of two-sided street, and it goes both ways. And I think that's really important to thinking about what we can do and what you, particularly as Americans, can do to help us resolve this issue. So yeah, this is just a quote from our letter, and I want to move back. This is just a photo I forgot to show you of a demonstration of ours outside prison with the Shmini's team. Move on. Okay, I'm not going to go into the great details of the economy of occupation because I think everyone can read about it on their own, and I just want to refer you to at least one website, which is Who Profits, which is an Israeli collective that does work, investigative work on corporations, both Israeli, international, multinational, that are complicit or in fact benefiting in a very direct way from the occupation. And I think you'll find a lot of analysis and a lot of good information on that website. It'll link you to other campaigns that are going on in this country around the economy of the occupation. Economic activism is something that you as Americans, I'm sure, are familiar with. You have a very rich and beautiful tradition of that in your country. And now in this, I hear laughter, I think, compared to Israel. And I think that, and at the end I can speak more to what you can do now. But I want to just to give you an overview, a little bit of a sense of what I mean when I say that the Israeli economy is reliant upon the occupation, the Israeli state, in fact. So the economic exploitation runs deep, and I'm not going to go into all of it just because of time, but just to give you a sense, we have the Palestinian labor, and I think Jane has spoken to that, and others will probably, but we basically have an entire population of slaves, in essence, because they are either not paid at all or paid way less than minimum wage. Labor laws do not apply to Palestinians, and they are often forced to come illegally, as in without permits, into Israel to work for us. They, in fact, often are forced to construct the settlements themselves on their own lands and not paid for it adequately. But they do all sorts of, all the dirty work that the Israeli society doesn't want to do is ostensibly done by the Palestinian working class. And you have sort of a burgeoning of the security industry, and again, I'm not going to go into that because it's just so huge. But weapon trade is Israel's second largest source of income as a state. If you go back in time, and I wish I had more time to talk about this, but almost virtually every and any dictatorship in the world in the last 30 years has had some contact with the Israeli security industry, whether it's training, whether it's weapons, whether it's sort of security technologies. Israel does not hide this fact. It's a big exporter of it. And one of the main reasons that it has become such a world-renowned exporter of security technologies or sort of so-called counterinsurgency technologies is because we use these technologies on the Palestinian people, we test them out, and then we sell them. And so the occupation is incredibly integral to our sustenance and to our economic success and growth as a state. And these are just some of the many examples. And I just want to show two pictures, maybe just to show you, I think Jane said really well before, where she, about Palestinians who have to get up, or someone mentioned it, about early in the morning in order to get to work, and even if they do, they are not guaranteed success. These are some pictures, and as you can see by the time of day, it is probably around 2 or 3 a.m., and Palestinians are forced to line up for hours for the privilege of being underpaid workers of the Israeli state. Go back, I'll tell you. So how did that lead to how did that inform my activism, and what kind of activism am I talking about? So as I said, my time in jail and all of this information that I have solely learned led me to join a group after my release from prison called New Profile. It's not really a group, it's more of a movement. And it's New Profile is the feminist movement for the demilitarization of Israel, or we like to call it otherwise the civilization of Israel. Not in a sort of colonial sense, but in terms of turning it into a more civilian country. And part of the main premises of this movement, as a feminist movement, is to say we are living in a country that is ostensibly, as Ivan has called it, a military state. And this is terrible for pretty much everyone involved, women, minorities, Jews of Middle Eastern descent, certainly the Palestinians. And we are all trapped in this sort of system that is benefiting very few of us. I mean, in some ways, yes, the entire Israeli society is a beneficiary of the occupation, as I have said before. But in other ways, we are all victims of it as well, certainly the Israeli working class. And so, what we do in New Profile is to A, raise awareness. We try to explain, and we have a lot of campaigns and exhibitions and lecture series trying to educate the Israeli public about the fact that we are, in fact, a militarized society. And this may come as quite a surprise to you. Isn't it common knowledge? No, it's not, actually. Most people do not know and do not recognize, because we don't know any other way. And I think Iran also spoke to that a little bit before. It's sort of become background to us, and Israelis are often not recognizing that we are, in fact, living in a military state. So that's one of the things that we try to do. And we try to give images from popular culture sometimes to help exemplify this. And I think I'll just give you one. Not that one, the next one. Just, I like to give it sometimes because I think it's poignant, and I think it kind of gives a sense of what we're talking about in terms of how the military industry or industrial complex has sort of permeated so many aspects of Israeli life, including advertising. This is a advertisement for medication, and the caption reads, my son is a combat soldier. The tension, the pressure, the telephones. I asked my pharmacist for Clomazene, and it helped me to calm down, started functioning properly again. And so besides the fact that this is a medical solution for a what I would argue is a social problem, what we like to talk about in this ad is what it says about our society, but particularly what it says about the role of women in our society. Women in Israel are not very much seen as political beings. We don't make it to the ranks of generals. We are not seen as worthy of an opinion, certainly not with regards to politics. What we can do is to refer to our soldier sons in combat and be concerned and sort of play the sort of mothers of the nation role. And so that's one of the things that we at New Profile try to talk about. And we have set up alternative education centers, and we educate youth, and we try to provide a different education, an alternative education, an education that I wish that I had growing up in Israel, that I had access to, that gives a different perspective, that tries to foster critical thinking and a different kind of discourse that is not so overrun by military rhetoric. So I think I'll end there just with saying that I really urge you all to look more into an incredibly successful campaign that was started by a large part of Palestinian civil society back in 2005, which is the BDS, Boycott, Divestment, Sanction movement. It's modeled after the South African movement under apartheid. And we have seen tremendous success, especially in Europe, but also in the United States right now. And the pressure is being felt. And I can tell you that in Israel, Israelis are talking about it. It's in the news. Everyone is concerned about it, that we are increasingly becoming a pariah, that we are being ostracized in the world for these kinds of policies. And we're also feeling it in our pocket. And unfortunately, that is probably the only way that Israelis are going to really ever come around. And I say this with great sadness, but I really think this is the only way.
That's our program for today. See you next week at this time. I'm Stanley Heller, and this is The Struggle.